See the video, audio. Get the audio stream, the video stream. This new system is running a whole lot faster than the old system did to get the streams up and running.
You're referring to the JCC system?
Well, the OBS I'm running instead of Google Hangouts.
Oh, okay, yeah.
All right. Well, welcome everyone. Saturday, December 17th, Apple Cider Q&A. Uncle Bob and I are starting the show again. Had a storm this morning. Might be more storm this afternoon. Nobody knows. All right, so general meeting. The website should be saying your meeting and my meeting.
We didn't have anybody today.
WordPress is getting a little flaky on me, I think. It's not updating the meeting notices. Yeah, I wondered if we'd be busy at the shop this morning, and we were. Some people like going out in the terrible weather, some people hate it. Old joke I read once about a guy wanting to shop for a car. So on a miserable blizzard of a day, you know, he's going to go look for a new car. And his wife was saying, "Are you crazy? You know, you don't want to go out in this weather like this." And he says, "Oh, they'll be really excited to sell. They probably don't have anyone coming there. I'll get a great deal." So he makes his way to the car dealership, trudges through the snow, gets into the showroom, and
Well,
the salesman said, "Hey, you must really want a car to come out in this weather. I can jack up the price."
What's the Wi-Fi here again?
It's Tech Age Class.
No cash.
And it's that's the Wi-Fi name.
Oh, yeah, it sees that.
Joel, Elias, and a number. Well, the 5G, so wireless brings up a good question. Wireless is broken into two radio spectrums. 2.4 gigahertz is considered the junk spectrum. And that's what all of the sort of regular wireless devices use.
Which one should I opt for?
TechH 5G. And so 5G is 5 gigahertz band. It's less crowded than the 2.4 gigahertz, but it doesn't go through walls as well.
Are these both Joel Elias?
Craig and Jay, J-E-Y, you said?
Yes. Yep.
C-R-A-I-G-A-M-D-J-A-Y. Yeah. So in if there are too many people connected to your 2.4 gigahertz, or there are too many other radio devices, garage door openers, portable phones, your microwave oven is 2.4 gigahertz, that's in the microwave band, then all that congestion can make your devices run slower. So the 2.4 gigahertz can be congested. The 5 gigahertz often is not as congested, because not as many devices are using it, but it doesn't go through walls as well as 2.4. So if you're closer to the router, then the 5 gigahertz might work better. We often see houses have a lot of problems with kitchens, all the metal in the kitchen, and then the microwave oven. So if your router is on one side of the kitchen and your computers are on the other side of the kitchen, that can be a problem getting through. And what typically happens is when the internet people come to set up internet in your house, they always come into an outside wall, because that's easiest to get the wires into your house. And then your office, most of the time, I don't know why this works, but most of the time your office is on the other end of the house. So you've got to get your Wi-Fi through the entire house. It would be best to put the Wi-Fi right in the center of the house because it's a radio sphere. So it would get out to all ends of the house. So what a lot of companies are starting to do now is they're creating what's called a mesh network. So in the olden days, you would get a second router and put it halfway through the house to pick up the signal from the first one and rebroadcast it and set it out. They were sometimes called a repeater or a range extender or something like that. And they were often tricky to set up. You had to configure your first one to tell it there's a second one, then the second one has to point to the first one. So it got a little tricky to set up. As the wireless technologies progressed, the current wireless AC has much longer range, much higher power, and it has a feature called beamforming. So instead of being a radio sphere, it can detect where your computer is and give it a tight beam. And you get better signals that way. Other companies are now starting to do what are called mesh networks. Let me see if I can find a picture of it. So Eero, it was one of the first ones, E-E-R-O. And so what it does is you generally like buy a three-pack, and one of them goes on your main internet connection, because wherever your internet feed comes in, and then you put other ones throughout your house where you need to get extended range or longer distance. And it was always ironic because Wi-Fi has a nominal range of 300 feet, and houses aren't that big. But that 300 feet is line of sight, no obstructions. So if you had like a garage, 200 feet away from your main house, that would be fine. But you put a tree in the middle, now you're 100 feet. You put a concrete wall in the middle, now you're 50 feet. So these wireless devices, and they use a new technique called the wireless mesh, and they, in essence, set themselves up to help cover your house a lot better. Google has one now, the Google Wi-Fi, which is similar to the Eero. The Google ones are a little less expensive. They're about $100 a piece. The Eeros are about $200 a piece. The three-pack is like $450, so you get a break if you buy the three-pack of Eero. But the Google Home is the same sort of thing. You buy one, and then you may put other ones around your house to extend the range. There's always that dead spot where you can't get coverage in one room of the house where you want it. Someone listening on a podcast was joking about that. We can pick up signals from Pluto. The New Horizons spacecraft just went by Pluto, but I can't get Wi-Fi in my bedroom. and then they pointed out that the signal from Pluto is coming in at 1 kilobit per second. And your Wi-Fi is typically 1 million kilobits per second. But the bigger difference is the antenna. The Deep Space Network has an antenna that's several thousand miles wide. And over the years, we've seen that with cell phones. The very first cell phones had a really big antenna on them. And the antennas got smaller and smaller. And then for a while, they were retractable. So you pull the antenna out to talk. You slide it back into the phone when you weren't using it. Then they were a stub, and now phones don't look like they have antennas at all because people didn't want antennas sticking out. But it's a radio. You need antennas. The bigger the antenna, the better the signal reception is going to be. So there's been this argument with the public where people don't want the antenna sticking out, but they still want good reception. So the antenna design inside the phone, and in most phones, the entire case becomes the antenna, is a big issue. So that was one of the, what was it, AntennaGate, was it the 4 or 4S iPhone came out? There were several different antenna around the outside, some for Wi-Fi, some for cellular. And if you held the phone just wrong, your hand would bridge the two antenna, thereby shorting them both out. So you'd lose your cell phone connection, you'd lose your wireless connection. And so that was one of the famous Steve Jobs answers. Someone complained that the antenna reception was bad, and he said, "You're holding it wrong." And so that's probably one of the last things that that Steve Jobs got criticized for, the "you're holding it wrong" speech. So just hold it differently. And, but in the next version, they moved the antennas around, so it's easier, and you don't have to worry about crossing the antenna with your hands. But if you could plug a big antenna onto your phone, you'd get really good reception everywhere you went. So you need a giant antenna. Even satellite television, we've seen that. It used to be like a 15-foot antenna, then an 8-foot antenna. And now, DirecTV is like a 12-inch or 18-inch antenna or smaller. You don't even have to put them on the roof anymore. If you've got a window facing the right direction, you can put it inside your house and point it out the window. So it's interesting to see how times have changed over the years.
I can't remember what movie I was watching recently. And I think they were showing scenes from Turkey or some Middle Eastern country, and it took me back to the 50s because everybody had antennas on the roof.
Yep.
Obviously not filmed in the U.S.
Yeah. When I was a kid, it was always trying to position the rabbit ears, and Dad would make me go over and move it while we... the three channels that came in.
Yeah. I still have a vivid memory of my first image I saw on TV. I came home from school. I walked home. I don't know where everybody was because I seemed to be alone. But I turned on the TV, and it was one of those roundish 9-inch screens, and the whole screen was filled with the face of Kate Smith saying, "God bless America." And that was
from Charlie's Angels?
No, way before that.
Yeah. About 53. So what we're seeing now is, like the olden days of broadcast television. That was Kate Jackson. Yeah. Like the old days of broadcast television, where you'd have an antenna on the roof. You can get free high definition broadcast television now with a digital antenna. And a lot of people do that to cut the cable TV cord. You can get like 20 different channels. Channel 10 has 3. Channel 31 has 3. I think channel 21 has 5.
Cutting the cord is HD antenna.
You get a digital antenna. You can get high def broadcast for free.
3 channel 8s, 3 channel 10s.
Hi there. Hi. This is the computer Q&A. Have a seat.
Oh, I'm just kind of passing.
You're gonna brush through? No problem. Yeah. and so one of the things is what angle do you point your antenna to pick up the stations? And if you point it, toward Buffalo, you get some Buffalo stations. Point it toward Syracuse, you get Syracuse stations. So there's
it's got 3.
Yeah, now of them will have different, so they can point multiple directions at the same time.
But it just sits up in the corner. None of them are articulated. They all straight up.
Yeah, and
just put them in different positions.
Some of the old days, the antennas had a little motor on them, so you could turn a dial in your house, and the antenna would move itself to tune in the next station. So there's a website called AntennaWeb that will show you what direction to point your antenna to get the broadcast channels. So I put in my zip code here, and so some channels are harder to get because you need to have your antenna up high again. So we're back to line of sight transmission. So if you can put your antenna on your roof or up a tree. So channel 10 has one. Channel 13 has 2. 21. Channel 20. Don't know channel 20. So some of these channels are available on cable, and some of them are not. And vice versa. There's one called Comet TV that's only available on broadcast that isn't on cable. And so if I put in a different zip code, where do I change my zip code? Let's go back here and put my zip code in here. Let's put a different zip code in. If you put your whole address in, it probably gives an even better signal. So there. You've got a lot of different stations available to you at different angles. So we got Rochester. And I can scroll. We got some.
Antenna's rated for mileage. It's like a 60-mile, some are 30, some are 60.
Yep. So you can get 31 channels over the air from 10 different stations, high def, digital broadcast for free without paying for cable. Many times it's just buying an antenna. In fact, I saw an infomercial once for, I think they called it free digital TV for $20, you know, lifetime free digital TV. And it was just an antenna you plugged into the back of your television. But it was a small antenna that you plug into your television, so it may not work as good as having an antenna outside with a wire running to it, or a big antenna on top of the television. So it's kind of interesting where you can get stuff. The other thing that Time Warner does is they charge you extra for the cable guide. So if you want to see the programming guide on your TV, you pay extra for that. Well, you can use apps like TV.com or TVGuide.com, and that gives you...
The antenna brings in a TV guide.
Yep. That'll come in for free without needing to pay for it. So save $3 a month.
I don't know who's providing it, but...
Yep. Yeah, so you can save some money by turning that off.
And I saw nowhere to change preferences.
What your time zone is.
Well,
it might be coming from us.
Right now, the time zone's daylight savings time.
It may not be corrected for daylight savings time, yeah.
But I don't see anywhere to correct it. It's there.
Yeah.
I'm surprised to even discover it.
So Titan TV is one of the internet TV guides. And then there's always TVGuide.com. So you can get a TV guide without needing to pay for it. The one thing it doesn't do is tell your DVR to record. So you'd still have to do that manually. So that may be worth the $3 a month they charge you for the guide. Being able to hit a button and tell it to record.
I'd have to buy a DVR. One to $300.
Yep. And with a lot of shows being available on demand from the show website or the network website, you may not need a DVR to record it because you just watch it again on demand.
The only thing we're kind of tethered to is CBS. Carol likes Friday Night's Blue Blood and so on. CBS doesn't make their stuff available on demand.
And many CBS shows you need to pay for the CBS All Access to get to them. Well, especially if you want some of the older ones.
You know, via the antenna. But on demand, we'd have to pay.
Oh.
No, thank you.
There's a webisode in the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. universe. I didn't know they made this one. So sometimes the shows are only on the web, and you don't get them on broadcast or cable.
Yeah, like Hulu original content.
Yeah.
I have a question when we...
Sure.
I have an iPad app question and an iPad mail question. Which would you rather...
Well, let's start with the app one, then we can do the mail one.
Scrabble. We have Scrabble. It's on Carol's iPad, but we use only my Apple account for, syncing it and so on. It says update available. And this is what we get, update available. I don't know if I...
you got to get the iPad on the internet.
We don't have it set. Well, this one was set here before. Okay, Tech H5, that's Craig.
Craig and Jay. So it looks like the last update for that was December 6th.
For Scrabble?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, the trick is it the official Scrabble or is it one of the Scrabble knockoffs?
I don't know. That can actually answer. Scrabble.
That looks like the official Scrabble from Electronic Arts.
Hasbro. Update. Sign into Apple. Now, here it says roberthoy@mac.com, so I'm going to put it in mine. This thing screwed me up, so I was forced to change my Apple ID. I won't get into that right now. But
you have to.
But I did change my Apple ID, and this is the correct one.
So that's the new ID?
Yes.
So if you change your ID, you have to sign out of it in all the places on the iPad, so you sign into the new one.
It was changed a couple weeks ago. So it's, okay, so I say okay.
Down there, it's now, also telling you you've got updates.
An Apple ID verification code is required to sign in. So now we got this.
Yep, so you have two-factor authentication turned on for your Apple ID.
You're being used to sign in device near Buffalo. That's this one, I presume.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So allow.
Yeah. And that should give you a code.
Yeah.
Now retype your password with that code at the end.
Where?
So so type your password followed by the code on your device. So hit retry. Now type in your password and followed by that code.
Okay.
So that's part of the security model to have a second factor in order to buy something. Even though this is a free purchase, it's still considered a purchase.
That idea that you have to put it in and then you put the code in on the same line with your ID, that's
new.
Yeah, it's not intuitive. Cannot connect to iTunes stores.
Different problem. So I'll try again with that same code. Now, you should be able to make that a trusted device so it doesn't ask you all the time.
Yeah, connect that to. But if that's the procedure, I'll try that at home and I'll let you know if I need further help.
Mm-hmm. So you can go to the Apple ID website, appleid.apple.com. And
where would... You're way more savvy than I am. I'm way more savvy than the average person. And I don't understand. I didn't understand that. How would the average person come to know that you put that in after the ID on the same line?
Because it said so on the message.
It said enter it, but it didn't say where. Because there's one place where you enter your ID, and there's some place where you enter this code. The idea that you merge them.
It said on screen, enter your Apple ID followed by the... code.
Okay. Well, if that comes over again, I'll... But I didn't read it that way.
And when you set up two-factor authentication, it told you that then, too. But no one remembers because they just set that up long ago.
I didn't know. Okay.
You can go to the appleid.apple.com website and make a device trusted so that it doesn't ask you that all the time. The danger is if someone gets your device, well, they'd have to get your device and your password, then they could buy stuff without that second factor.
Is this your code?
Oh, yeah.
Can I sit here?
No, you...
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Hi. Email problem.
Yep.
I get email on my home iMac, and I've had trouble with that, which I've been able to negotiate. But here's my... phone. I got 17 messages on my phone currently. That sounds about right. And my iPad shows none.
Okay.
and I'm not sure why. It says roberthoy@mac.com. That's my email address.
There can be, well, two things. You need to make sure. Howdy.
Hi, how are you?
Good. You need to make sure the mail server settings are the same on all your devices. And the protocol is the same. This goes back to what we were talking about Wednesday. They both or all devices should be set up for IMAP, and the server address should be the same on each one. Generally speaking, Apple sets up the iCloud addresses properly on each device. And then there is a bug I've seen with the Mail app where it doesn't update the unread count. And so you may not have 17 unread messages.
I had on the iMac, but that's not this problem. This problem. So you're saying in my mail, I got to set this to be the same as that.
Right. Under accounts, under iCloud. Okay, it's not giving me the account settings. Maybe it's thinking something there. Yeah, that's probably where it's coming from. So one fix is to delete the mail account and then add it back again.
Okay. That would be a good idea, I think.
Yeah, if you turn off mail here. So any mail you have saved on the device is going to be deleted.
I've never gotten anything. Now this is my new part of the deal with my new iPhone.
Your discounted iPad.
For
$100.
And that leads to another question. I just got my bill. They're charging me $10 a month for service on this, and I assume that's for the
cellular data, yeah.
But I haven't asked for any cellular data. I didn't know I was signing up for any cellular data.
That was probably in the fine print, $10 a month. There is a cellular data button up here that will tell you how much you've used since the last reset. So these are the devices that you've allowed to use cellular data, which you may want to weed and turn off. And so that's how much cellular data you've used since you've last reset it on that date. And there should be a button up there somewhere. Manage account will tell you how much data you're getting in that $10 a month plan. You know, 1 gig, 2 gig, 3 gig. No, so you can't look at it on there. You got to call them for it.
Yeah, I'm planning going in.
So a lot of times that's in the fine print. The discount you get for buying the cellular device is paid for by the monthly plan you're going to pay for. And they probably just add it to your current bill rather than giving you a separate bill.
Well, that was definitely not just in small print, but that was in the sales pitch. Because I'm waiting on my phone. She brings out my new phone. And she has a brand new, iPad.
Yeah.
Oh, well, you can get this by now only for $100. It's listed as $300, something like that. And get this, you pay $50 now and the other half when your first bill comes through.
And then probably $10 a month for a 2-year commitment to make up for that.
I didn't hear that part.
Yep. That makes up for the $300 discount they gave you.
Yeah, I got my iPhone 6 for free because I pay so much a month.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, at that point, I don't even know if I was clear that it was cellular iPad. I have another one, which I turned around and sold for the same price I paid for this. So, that works out. But
you can probably go on the AT&T website to manage your account. Go in and talk to them,
It looked like the same girl. They had the sexy girl in the commercial.
Yep.
The guy buys something and he's so enthralled with her, he's stumbling over himself. It looked like the same girl.
Did you get to meet her?
Well, no. Maybe I mentioned it. I said something about that. I said, I'm supposed to say goodbye to you. Anyway, maybe that's why I didn't hear what she had to say.
Yeah, her name is Milana Alexandrovna Vyantrub. She's Uzbeki. She was a model and actress. And then she got this gig, and now she's world famous.
You know, I asked Siri the question, I want to get laid. She said, I'm sorry, I can't help you.
Yeah.
So I turn mail off here. That's not deleting the account, though, right?
No, it just removes it from your iPad. So now if you go to your mail app, it won't show you any mail for the iCloud account.
No, it wasn't showing me any anyway.
Well, yeah, and it should even say, yeah, you don't even have an account. So I would say now reboot the iPad and then go back in and turn mail back on. No, just the sleep button, and leave it off for a few minutes, and then turn it back on.
There's no filter button you're living with there.
I don't know. I get an email on my. Carol gets it on her iPad. I get it on my iMac. I get it on my phone. I don't get it on this one.
So there are.
What did you pull her name on?
I searched for AT&T actress, and that pops up.
Wow.
Usually you'll find, so here's hot pictures of her, because she was a model before she got this gig.
29 years old.
Usually you'll see different pictures of the different spokespeople. Who's the other one? The T-Mobile girl. So she's from Uzbekistan. But when did she come here? So her English is really good. Oh, she was 3 when she came here. So she started doing Barbie commercials when she was 5.
I'm learning Swedish. I'm on my 3rd extended series watching on TV. That are Swedish. I watched The Bridge. Which Swedish edition, 36 episodes. Now I'm watching Wallander, which is 20 episodes, and all Swedish, with subtitles, of course. Yeah.
Oh, who's that singer that was the Rick roll that was happening for a while? Instead of the Rick Ashley one, you got this other one. Yeah.
Law.
York is nice.
What was his name? I can see it, I can hear it, I just can't think of the lyrics. The Rick roll that isn't Rick Astley. Oops, I spelled Astley wrong. Tra-la-la, that's what it is. Tra la 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 la. Let me see if I can find it. There he is. So this was popular going around the internet for a while. All right. I would prefer not to give my age. I'm old. Oh, that may not be Swedish. That looks Cyrillic. I don't know why that got popular, but that got real popular for a while.
Okay, so I've logged back in.
And then go into settings.
My two-party identification.
Yep. Go into settings and turn mail back on.
Enter passcode.
Oh, Family Guy parodied him. The Trololo guy.
So I'm in settings, and I'm going to start my order.
Yeah. Yep, turn mail on. Try tapping a little farther to the right. It's not a slide, it's a tap.
I know.
Now you're too far to the right, it brought up the second window. slide from the left edge of that window. Slide from the top lets you pick different windows. There you go. So now you should be able to go to the Mail app, and it should synchronize your email. Go back home and then open the Mail app. It may still be looking. Let's see if we go back a page, swipe down, make it look for mail. So it doesn't think you have any mail on that account.
Yeah.
Well, we gotta start over. I missed it. Yeah. Twelve, so that's when that got big. All right, I just sent you a message on that account. You know, you're big when you get parodied on TV.
I got it at AT&T, but there's AppleCare, you know, like the initial warranty. If I take this into the Genius at ECU, would that be a strategy?
You could.
He's a better Genius.
The next step would be to sign out of iCloud completely and sign back in. That shouldn't be necessary. But that's probably the next step, and then the next step after that is erase it and restore from backup. Now, what if we send a message? Does that work? Oh, here we go. Now they're coming in. It said 18 messages. There they are. So it just took a minute. So 18 unread of your...
It's yours.
Yeah. So you delete it on the one, it's deleted at the server, and it will remove itself from the other one.
Now it's called inbox. I think I had... Mine just says Bob. You can rename the inbox, right?
I think so, but I don't... Generally, no. If you have multiple mail accounts, then it will show each one with its own.
What are these? This is a folder, roberthoy@mac.com.
That's a folder you've created in your inbox. That's the problem. There was nothing in that folder, so it didn't show us anything.
But I tried the inbox before, and it didn't have anything there.
And so that's another folder in the inbox.
So we should delete those folders. If I want a folder, well, inbox is, there's two different mail accounts. It's Carol's got her own.
Well, right now, you've only got one mailbox set up.
Yeah, I don't need to get hers on this one.
Yeah.
Hers comes on that one.
So that's probably what it is, that second inbox account. So generally speaking, you give people their own email address. But we know a lot of couples where the husband and wife share an email address and they just ignore messages that aren't meant for them and let the other person look at them. It's usually easier to get your own address.
Hers and mine are both on the iMac. You know, it says hers, and mm-hmm. you click on that and you see her email. Click on the other one, you see mine. But we each have a distinct email addresses.
Yeah, you could set that up as a separate account on the device if you wanted her to. Yeah.
We just have one account on the computer. So.
So if I go into my inbox preferences, I can make an alias. Oh, I forgot I did that. So I've got MacManSteve at Mac.com.
Well, before I wouldn't get to the App Store, but it looks like I might be at the App Store now.
Yeah. So in the bottom, there's the Update tab, which shows you, the little badge there showed you how many updates are waiting. You can turn on automatic updating if you want.
Try to update your subscriber.
Yeah, find it from the list, and then you can update. Let me get my mirroring set up. All right, Al. I need to update. There we are. So in your settings, under iTunes and App Store, you have an option to automatically download things. So if you buy music or apps or books on another device, they'll automatically download to this device. Generally speaking, you'd keep those off. Most people use their devices for different things. The phone and the tablet use it for different things, so you wouldn't want all the same apps on both. But updates, you may want to automatically download. So whenever an app gets updated, it downloads itself. Yes, each device has to be updated separately, so you would turn on this auto update on each one. We sometimes jokingly call this the Dick Cheney feature. Tim Cook was apparently testifying before Congress on something else, and Dick Cheney asked him, "Why do I have this 75 badge, you know, on my phone all the time? Why can't they update themselves?" And so they added the auto update feature. The problem is it can be dangerous. If the update is buggy, the program will crash and quit working. And if it's a program you use all the time, then you're screwed until the other end fixes it.
Well, every time I see an update, I have to explicitly authorize it.
Not if you turn auto updates on.
Oh. Well.
Then it updates itself.
So you're saying I'm better off not doing it.
Yeah, but it's more work on your part. And in general, we rarely see critical problems happen during updates.
But malware is less likely to slip in, though.
Well, it's updating an existing program. It's not putting a new program in. So it's unlikely to be malware. But if they made an error and there's a bug in the program may not work right until they fix the bug, which is usually only a few hours or a day anyway, because they don't want to upset all their customers with a program that doesn't work.
When the screen pops up on the screen, it's saying that, you know, there's an update call for it. Sometimes I just
That's always the best thing. When you get an update notice, you can't necessarily trust it. because the bad guys will put fake update notices.
Yeah.
So you get a notice to update your flash, don't click on that notice, go to the Adobe website and download it yourself.
That's where I've been doing
it. Yeah, you get an update for Java, same thing.
Yeah.
It used to be you'd get QuickTime update notices, but Apple doesn't do those anymore. The QuickTime is updated in the OS, so you won't get a QuickTime update notice. But many times when you're going to a website, you have to download this viewer to view the video on the website.
Mm-hmm.
And many times that's a fake message to download. And so you download what you think is a viewer, you install it yourself because you think you need to play the video, and it installs something malicious. So it's, in general, never trust any of that.
The most frequent updating that I get is I have Office for Mac. And,
monthly.
Yeah.
Microsoft comes out with monthly updates, and they're huge.
Uh-huh.
Takes forever to download it. It's very frustrating.
But in that case, I've just been doing it by clicking on Yes, I Agree, as opposed to trying to go back to some Microsoft site.
Yeah. If you learn what the real programs look like, that can often help. On the Mac, the App Store, where's my icon? App Store icon, the circle with the A on it. So if that's the program telling you there's an update, that's probably legitimate. The Microsoft app, let me find it here, is green. And they have it hiding pretty good inside your system because you usually don't go to it yourself. I think it's green with an A on it. The Microsoft Auto Update. I don't know if there's a birthday party scheduled today or not. I'm covering their sign with my sign.
Well, they should give
us some tea. Yeah. And we'll go to Microsoft and auto update. And so that's the Microsoft auto update icon. So that one is a good icon.
Okay. Oh, it doesn't look familiar. I'm using it. Yeah.
So there are a lot of fake updates, usually for Flash. Let's see, I thought I was saving some of them, maybe not. And they generally have the wrong icon.
This guy's looking for something out there, maybe a birthday party.
Hi there. Come on in.
Later.
Yeah. It's one of my customers from my store. As are you. Who comes first, one of the things we've joked about with the fake Flash updates is they were using the wrong color red, and they had the wrong logo. So Adobe's logo is a white F on a red field, and the fake one was a red F on a white field. So we said, "What? Take another 10 seconds and make the right icon." The bad guys find holes in Flash all the time, and so Adobe releases updates to Flash almost weekly, and so many times you go back to a website a week later and you have to update your Flash anyway.
And it's better I go to adobe.com.
To get it yourself, yep. Many browsers, Safari and Chrome and Firefox now, so all the major browsers, the current versions will not tell the other end you have Flash. The web in general is trying to kill Flash. Because of all the bugs and the security holes, they're trying to stop people from using Flash. So what happens when you go to a Flash site in the latest browser, in fact, let me go to the Flash Player website. Yep. So you have to go to Oracle to get that.
And they said I should use Internet Explorer.
Yeah. When you go to a website that uses Flash, That's not what I wanted. Well, let me back up a step. When you go to a website, your browser tells the website, here's the media I can play. All the different formats, you know, QuickTime and Flash and HTML and this, that, and the other thing. And the website then says, okay, I'll give you this video. So all the major browsers now have stopped telling the other end you have Flash. In most cases, the other end will then use HTML5, which is the replacement for Flash, basically. It's a better video player. Yeah, many of them have used Flash, and this actually started like 5 or 6 years ago now, because Flash isn't available on the iDevices. So companies had to change their websites to work on an iPhone without having Flash. Adobe did make Flash for Android, but it's such a battery hog that they abandoned it, you know, within a year or two.
You mean I can't use Flash now?
No, you never could use Flash on an iPhone.
Oh, on the phone.
Yeah.
Or just desktop.
Yeah. So because there never was Flash on the iPhone, most companies have moved away from Flash on the desktop and will send HTML video. But if you go to a page that needs Flash, there'll be a screen that says you need to install Flash. If you click on it, you'll often get a message, especially in Safari, if you want to trust that Flash. Trust using Flash. It's under privacy, I think. And security. You can tell what websites you want to use Flash, and in most cases, so I've had to tell my DNC to turn Flash on because DNC still uses Flash. Let me set it to ask, and we'll go back to the DNC. And then we'll get a different message telling us we need to enable Flash. Or maybe now the DNC will have updated itself to use HTML5.
Well, the sign of the Democratic building says DNC digital. It doesn't say
Democratic. I just saw that the other day.
Oh, yeah, there's the new logo. So can I hit play? The other problem we've had for years is that ads often use Flash to make, you know, animation and jumping. So by blocking Flash, you're actually blocking ads. And especially on a mobile device, those ads eat up your cellular data. Yeah. In fact, DNC is one of the websites that will detect you have an ad blocker and tell you to turn it off.
Yeah. I'd rather just not read the article because it says disable the ad block, and I'm not sure if that's a temporary disabling for the ad block purpose or a permanent that I'd have to go back and reinstall.
Yeah. It depends on which blocker you're using.
Yes, there you are. Thank you.
I'm just talking about pitching the other day.
Oh, neat. Yeah, they changed it on the front of the building.
Right in front of many companies.
Yep. So, all right, let's see. Are they using HTML? I don't think. I set my Flash to ask, so they're not asking me, so they must have switched to HTML5. Many of the older websites still use Flash for games, and that becomes an issue now. The one thing we did see, Forbes. Let me see if it still has it. Forbes has. An ad blocker detector. So if you try to go to the Forbes website with a blocker, you get a message. So now here's the message. Forbes wants to use Flash. So I can say, trust it forever. Not now, but ask me later. Or never trust. I usually do not now. And if I really want to see whatever their Flash thing is, I'll turn it on.
Yeah. And I just go ahead and click on that continue to site.
Yep. So now my ad blocker has blocked 25 ads already on the Forbes website. There was an issue last year where if you have an ad blocker running, Forbes popped up a big message, please turn off your ad blocker. And as soon as you turned off your ad blocker, a malicious ad popped up and installed malicious software in your computer. The Forbes website was infected with malware. So as soon as you turn off your ad blocker, you got infected. Mm-hmm. So what a lot of people have started doing is if the site doesn't work with an ad blocker, they just don't go back to that site. Or for sites you really do want to see, you can turn your blocking off. So I use a blocker called uBlock. And so if I want to allow ads on that website, I can. So that will click it on.
But you run the risk you display
that. Yep. You run the risk of getting a malicious ad. And many times the malicious ads install software to give you more ads. So then the chance of getting a malicious ad are even higher.
Does block ad block?
Sometimes. There was, was it uBlock? Might have been AdBlock. Figured out a way to block ads on Facebook. So then Facebook changed their website to block AdBlock.
Well, quite recently, Facebook found a way around
it. Right, yeah, so that was the joke for a while in one of the headlines. So Facebook could block AdBlock's blocking. So then AdBlock changed the blocking block so that Facebook was blocked, and then Facebook was able to block the blocking block.
Versus spy.
Yeah, and it just spiraled into a mess.
And that's a pain on Facebook, especially on the iPhone.
Yeah.
All those ads.
Well, and it's even worse now because ads, you kind of can tell it's an ad, and you sort of live with it. We're used to them. But there's such a huge problem in fake news on Facebook that what is Facebook's responsibility for showing you fake news? Yeah. Yeah.
The Fox News reporter.
Oh, yeah.
48 years old. No necessary.
Yeah.
Turns out she's just looking Fox. But the headline makes it read like she died.
Yep. Well, and then that was the, what was it, Pizzagate?
Yeah, yeah.
There was a story on Facebook that Hillary Clinton was running a child sex slave in a basement of a New York pizza parlor, and the police refused to investigate.
It was in Northwest, in Seattle or someplace?
I thought it was New York.
I thought it was
Washington,
D.C., but...
Maybe it was Washington.
I probably heard Washington, I was thinking
yeah.
Washington.
Yeah,
he was, he had his rifle, and he was going to
right.
free the kids.
Yeah, he was going to free them because he was mad the police didn't investigate. And he ended up shooting at people. And the the police's flimsy excuse for not investigating was the pizza shop doesn't have a basement. But enough people saw that news story that they believed it, and there is a general concern that swayed the election. There were where did I read it? It was Macedonia, I think it was. Hundreds of people were writing fake news all day long and feeding Facebook.
Yeah. It's a small town. I don't know if it was Macedonia, but it was one of those countries. And the main economy in that small town
mm-hmm.
is
writing
fake
yeah
news.
Writing so fake news stories.
One guy was doing it, and you just wonder where he got the smarts and wherewithal to do all that,
mm-hmm.
but it spread to some of his buddies, and so they had a regular cottage industry churning it out.
And they got money out of it?
Yeah.
Yeah, they got money for writing fake news. The more they write, the more they get. And so there's a real...
Like, $60,000 a month or something like that for ads. Ads, people would create a website, and then they'd subscribe to somebody's automatic... ad clicking stuff, and so on.
How about all these contests that are very, or quizzes that are very interesting? Can you recognize the artist from the original painting? And there's 50 examples, but as you go through it, there's ads involved in these pages.
Yep.
And you got to scroll down and find the particular one that says continue, because there's other triangles that you can click first, which take you right to
add. To add,
yeah. Do you find any of these to be malicious?
That can be. The fact that you get more ads raises the risk of getting a fake malicious ad.
But if you don't click on that,
you don't have to click on it. Just displaying it can activate.
So the best thing is just to avoid those quizzes.
Yeah.
They're fun.
Or make sure you have an ad blocker turned on, yeah. But there's a lot of speculation and a real fear that this fake news was able to sway the election. The Russian hack of the DNC, I think it was Washington Post was reporting that the RNC was hacked too. But the Russian hacker group wanted to sway the election in favor of Trump, and we've already seen now Trump's new Secretary of State is the CEO of Exxon. Yeah. Now he'll be able to reverse the oil embargoes that the U.S. has against Russia. And so, of course, Russia would want Trump to win, so now it's more favorable trade with Russia in Russia's favor.
Yeah, and the speculation was the reason they didn't anything that they found with the RNC was that they can hold it back for blackmail.
Yeah. It's so scandalous they're going to have it for blackmail. So maybe they're blackmailing Trump into appointing this guy to be the Secretary of State.
I don't know if it would be a conspiracy theory or not, but I heard somebody make a cogent case where people that most would be interested in black or impeaching Trump are Republicans.
Because they put for Pence.
Right, because then they get a real Republican instead of just a crazy man. And then it's plausible.
Yeah. So here's Snopes is getting on it too, trying to combat Facebook's fake news.
But Snopes can be trusted. It's not as if somebody could put on a fake Snopes.
Snopes does research to try to find sources to the stories.
Right, but can somebody put on a fake Snopes that looks like it's real Snopes?
Yeah.
Yes, so you have to make sure you're going to therealsnopes.com. And I don't like their new website. It's harder to tell whether something is real or fake now. So does a Harvard professor want the Electoral College to reject Trump? It just says fact check.
That's Lawrence Lessig, I think.
Yeah, Lawrence Lessig. He's CEO of Oracle, isn't he?
Oh, that's Larry Ellison.
That's Larry Ellison, yeah.
He was also a candidate for president.
Yes, this Larry Lessig was, yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
So the fact that he's a Harvard law professor, does that really mean anything?
Well, they're
trying to get the electors. I haven't seen lately, but there was one elector that was indicating that he was going to be faithless.
Yes, at least one.
Yeah. But many states, it's illegal for the electors to be faithless.
But they say that it's probably unconstitutional law.
Mm-hmm.
Faithless laws? I don't think it'd be unconstitutional.
Well,
the Constitution vests the states with the power and to decide how they're going to elect their electors. That's a state issue.
Well,
they have a right. If they want to have a faithless law, that's within their purview. That's the whole reason the Electoral College was set up, to give those states independent power.
And the small states have as much power as the big states.
That's why the Electoral College will not be eliminated.
Yeah, and the U.S. Constitution, as you suggest, does say that the states make the rules about the elections.
Right. But you can't get rid of the Electoral College for two reasons. One is Republicans control Congress. And they have a Republican president, and then it has passed 3/4 of the states.
Mm-hmm.
And states got more power because of it. Like Wyoming, which has fewer people than Rochester, they have 2 senators and a congressman. So they're not going to do that. But there is a way around it. And Al Gore mentioned it. I wish Obama had given it.
The compact of states.
The compact. It's a popular vote. Interstate compact.
Yeah.
And once you get enough states to agree to that, they constitute 270 electoral votes, then you can go around it, and then you got a popular vote system. And I think there's 160 popular or electoral votes that are already agreed to, including New York State. Our state has agreed to the compact. There's 160. You need 110 more electoral votes to commit. You understand the principle?
Yeah.
That
the state would have to cast all of their votes for the majority.
Yeah, 48 states doing all or nothing.
Even if their state went the other way.
Yep.
They would still have to buck up and say, I know we voted for candidate B, but A got the majority, so we're casting all.
But in general, the electors are elected because they're pro-party. So they generally won't be faithless. Yeah. There was one, I went through a list of all of the elections that had faithless electors. One of them was by accident. So the electors vote for president and vice president separately. And one guy accidentally reversed his ballots. So he put the vice president's name on the presidential ballot and the president's name on the vice presidential ballot. So he was technically faithless and didn't vote for the right person. Well, you want someone voting their conscience, not in fear of recrimination.
Because that's the way it was set up originally, was that it was to be a check on the public.
Because the public wasn't trusted, basically.
Because
most of the public was uneducated. And
I love the uneducated.
There was no...
back then, you didn't even vote for senators.
Well, that's true.
They were appointed by state legislatures.
That's true, but it's Alexander Hamilton who was saying that we need to check on the masses for the federal voters. But, what you're saying is correct about the U.S. government went out of its way to create extra power for rural areas with the splitting up the western territories into lots of states.
So here's the states that impose a fine or make it illegal.
Yeah. Now, the Dakota Territory is a single territory, but they created two states in order to double its electoral college representation.
Mm-hmm. And California should be five states. But the that was how the states got their shapes TV show. They went into the power that the early people had to prevent California from getting broken up. And that was one of the reasons the Electoral College was created, is so that a candidate would have to campaign in every state. They couldn't just go to the big states and get all the votes.
Well, still, they only go to the swing states.
Right now, they only go to the swing states, yeah, because it's interesting how population has sort of merged its way around.
It's when the demographics are getting close to a tipping point, like mm-hmm. Those become the swing states. And so there are people arguing now, like Cokie Roberts is arguing, that the Electoral College really benefits minorities.
Yeah. Yeah, this was interesting. In 1836, Virginia's entire 23 electorate didn't vote.
I think you read the article that I sent you the link to about the acting for Russia.
Yep.
I found that article fascinating. It was long, but lots of interesting detail read it for me.
So even some of the early electors. So a Democratic Republican used to be one party.
That's true. The word Republican dropped off until 1754.
So it's kind of interesting to read some of the history, and because, in fact, I was just talking about this morning with someone. The election is in November. The electors don't vote until December, and inauguration isn't until January. Because it might take a week to count the ballots, and then a month to drive the wagon train across the country.
That's right. It used to be March 4th, yes.
Yeah.
And a lot of people think that the Electoral College gathers in one great big place and all vote together. No, it's in the individual state capitals.
Yeah. Yeah, and it was interesting that there was a lot of concern about voting machine tampering.
Yeah.
Someone hacking into the voting machines and changing the votes, and didn't have to do that. The social engineering is easier. And we've talked about that in the past. The people don't necessarily have to break into your account or guess your password. They just call you on the phone. Hi, this is Bill from tech support. We need your password. Okay. Most of the time, people just give them the password because most people are trusting.
Mm-hmm.
And the bad guys prey on that.
Mm-hmm. The Constitution does not say, December 19th, does not specify just when it's going to be. It says Congress should have the date. So theoretically, Congress could change the date this weekend for the person that wanted
to. Change it for 4 years from now.
Well.
And then people are saying, what happens if Trump isn't elected by the Electoral College? Pence still could be.
He could be, and then he's become the acting president.
And if
no.
No, yeah. So then
he's
it goes.
President.
Well, he's acting president for the length of the Constitution under the scenario.
And then if there's still no winner. Then it goes to, I'm going to find it in here, I read it once. It goes to the House.
Mm-hmm.
You need an absolute majority of the House.
And
if there's still no winner, it goes back to the states.
But in the House, each state has one vote.
Yeah.
They've been playing out these scenarios in Lady Secretary. The TV show.
Oh, Madam Secretary.
Madam Secretary.
Secretary.
Yeah, because they've had the president, they're marshaling votes for the House of Representatives to, so they've been playing out these scenarios in their script.
Well, the Constitution does use the phrase acting president in this context, but when William Henry Harrison died, that was the first time a vice president had succeeded to the presidency, and a lot of his political opponents did not want to believe that he had the powers of the presidency. They said he's just an acting president. He's not a real president.
Mm-hmm.
But Tyler asserted himself and established the precedent that, yeah, Vice President Fifteen is the president.
These are the 11 states and.
Yeah.
May add up to 165. Pennsylvania and Michigan, I think, are the next two that have had bills entered in the state legislature to pass it. But somebody who had gone through that initial step had, withdrawn it.
Yep.
It might be in Arizona.
Pennsylvania's procedure for a recount means you've got to individually petition precinct by precinct, which made it almost impossible to do. But the real problem with the recount was not so much getting an accurate result by counting the votes in the cast, but by the voter suppression efforts that kept people from even being able to cast ballots in the first place. And things, particularly in minority areas, where there might have been 26 polling places, and they reduced it to one polling place, making it you have to really travel far in order to vote, and so a lot of people just did not vote.
Yep. And it says, so only twice has the House had to vote to elect a president, 1801 and 1825. And if the House can't do it, then it goes to the Senate, and you need an absolute majority in the Senate. And the only time that did it was 1837. And this is all under the 12th Amendment.
That was for Vice President.
Yeah, for Vice President, yeah.
Richard Johnson?
Yeah.
Or Francis Granger, who had been Postmaster General's son of Gideon Granger, both from Canandaigua. And Francis Granger became Postmaster General under Harris, who stayed on under Tyler.
So, under the 12th Amendment, if the House has not chosen a president-elect by Inauguration Day, the Vice President is acting President until the House sets a president.
It would be Biden.
No, the vice president-elect becomes acting president.
Oh, elect.
Yeah, so it would be Pence.
Unless he doesn't have enough votes.
Well, it's interesting. You call him vice president.
Yeah, because Trump could get enough electoral votes and Pence couldn't. Or vice versa.
Or they might both fail.
Yeah.
Well, I thought the Constitution was amended to say that the vice president and president are joined. They're both in the same status.
No, this was still saying you vote for each of them separately.
Well, here's a scenario that was laid out.
Vote separately, but they're not the same. Go ahead.
At the first hearing of Congress, Joe Biden remains president,
yes,
or vice president of the Senate.
Correct.
And they can enact certain measures before he inaugurates the new members. So they're not members of that session until he formally brings them in. So they can transact business before that.
That's correct, because Congress takes office January 3rd.
And they could vote where the House has the right to vote on a candidate. They could do it without the new members. And then after they take that action, then you got your president, and then he inaugurates the new members.
So. Oh, I have the impression that the old House.
I read one speculation once that if you eliminate the Electoral College, then the person with the most votes is president, and the second most votes is vice president. But then the vice president would have to have more power to .
That's what it was when Washington.
Yeah, and they could hate each other.
Yeah, he got the second. It was originally set up that you would have the president would be the most votes, second most votes would be vice president, even though they're from different parties.
Mm-hmm.
So,
and what you were just talking about was Hillary Clinton took office on January 3rd, 2001, while Bill Clinton was still president. Because he stayed in office until January 20th.
Okay.
So she was senator, but he was president.
Yeah. Well, any more computer questions?
Yes. I've been having some trouble with Wi-Fi.
Mm-hmm.
That it just goes on and off. Now, I do have that Netgear Wi-Fi range extender, and it works frequently, generally. But there's dropouts, and this past week I've been getting LTE all the time on my iPhone. And so it kicks me over the 1 gigabit data limit, which it hasn't for many weeks, or many months. So nothing got me this. And I don't know whether it's got enough capacity to be accurate for looking under an iMac and then substituting for the range extender from the modem, which is on a different floor.
This is only an N, so it's older. The AC technology has longer range and higher power.
So this is the 300 MPB as opposed to 600, which couldn't have been overworked. But enough that made a difference in, say, the videos that come on the iPhone.
It can make a difference. And also, how many people are using it at the same time?
Yes. Well, nobody's got it set up so that the single time Warner modem provides signal for the whole house.
Yep. And that's usually the way it is, and that's why you often needed to put range extenders around. One thing that we've seen happening, we mentioned it a little earlier before you got here, is several companies are coming out with new, what's been called mesh network. So there's the Google Home and the Eero are two of the big ones, where it's designed to work as multiple routers together. One main router, and then you put, I think they have a picture down here too, you put other routers in other areas of the house, and they all just talk to each other.
Oh.
That can be done with the older router technology, but it works the best if you use the same brand for each router.
Now, if they talk to each other, does that create security issues that people can read each other's emails?
Well, email is not secure, period. So, yeah. But as long as you have a password on the network, then the data on the network is encrypted.
Okay.
The data under wireless is encrypted.
I don't have to worry about secure wire email being compared to anybody else using the same router.
Right. So this could replace your Netgear router. It may not gain you anything because it's, from what I remember you said about your Netgear, it's the same technology. It's the N300 megabit.
Yeah.
So that could be a second router in another part of the house to pick up the signal and rebroadcast it. But if you've already got a repeater doing that, that may not.
Well, the range extender's on the second floor.
Mm-hmm.
And usually 2 gigabytes is reliable, but I prefer 5 gigabytes on the range extender. But it doesn't always hold up the strong enough signal. If I were to install this right now, would it be fighting the range extender?
Yes, you'd have to reconfigure the range extender to extend that one instead. Or configure this one to be another range extender to your first Netgear.
Because I could just turn off the range extender and use this. Because there's not that many people using the range extender. Other people are closer to the original router.
Yeah, it's not the number of people, it's the distance to the router.
Right. And the other people that are using it are second floor, first floor,
mm-hmm.
they can pick it up to the original router.
And the best way to have a range extender is to run a wire to it. Rather than having it wirelessly pick up the signal and rebroadcasting it, it's better if you can run one wire to it. But one of the points of having a range extender is you don't have a wire there.
Yeah, this is wireless because of the change of all that wiring.
Yeah.
So, from what I just said then, I think I'd prefer to have this on my desktop iMac so that I don't have to run into these issues of fade in, fade out. Would that solve that issue?
Well, you don't hook this to a computer. That's your network.
What do I hook this to? I thought it hooked into the
internet. No, you hook that to your internet modem.
Oh. So, is this a substitute for the range extender and it's stronger or something, or what?
It's a substitute. I don't know if it's stronger or not.
So, it just kind of duplicates the function of the range
extender. Yeah.
I thought there was something that I hooked into.
You would put a bigger antenna on the desktop to pick up the signal better.
But can't you also hardwire that to the computer?
Doesn't matter if that's not hardwired to the main router.
My iMac is hardwired to the main router.
So then that doesn't matter. You don't need that at all. Make that your main router. If you're having trouble with the Netgear, take the Netgear out and make the Buffalo the main router. You said your Netgear wireless router, you're having trouble with maintaining your wireless connection.
Yeah, it's been the last week LTE most of the time. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I got those concentric arcs.
Yeah. So it may be that your Netgear router is wearing out and needs to be replaced.
Oh, 6 months old.
Then it's under warranty, you get a warranty replacement.
Oh. Yeah, it's an updated model, too. The current model, it's not one of the
if it's a new, it wouldn't be more likely that it's configured improperly than that's defective?
It could be configured improperly, but the fact that it works at all is probably an indication that it is configured properly. The other issue is interference in the house. Do you have portable phones, a portable landline? And if so, what frequency are they on? Yeah, Mom. Is the kitchen between you and the router, or was it your phone? So the Mac shouldn't have any trouble because it's not using wireless, but your phones may have trouble with other interference in the house.
I've never had a problem with this iPhone in the house.
Well, which device is switching to LTE then?
Release it from Time Warner.
Did you just get rid of it? And
we added the Netgear wrench extender to that. The main router's on the first floor, and this wrench extender's on the second floor. I'm in the third floor.
A lot of times, old houses are a problem because of the construction. It's plaster over lath over chicken wire, which is a Faraday cage, which blocks radio signals.
never seen this open classroom know about the Pickenwire that might be the case.
Yeah.
This is about 1910. Is that the state of construction now?
I think so, yeah.
Maybe that's the issue. So I do have this cable coming directly to my iMac from the first floor router.
Mm-hmm.
So that signal is okay.
Right.
But how could we...
Are you on the second floor?
I'm on the third floor.
Third floor. You could plug that wire into that router, and then that router into your Mac.
Oh.
So your Mac would still be hardwired, but you're now creating an extended network from your office to the rest of the house.
So then
that area of the house.
Then the signal from this between the first floor router and my third floor iMac. Signal out of this would operate from my iPhone anywhere in my apartment.
Right.
And then it'd be stronger
than trying to reach all the way down to the Wi-Fi in the first floor, yeah.
I like that. So would that mean that it's fighting with range extender and we no longer need to use that? At least for me?
It could. Is the range extender you said was on the second floor?
Yeah. And
it could.
Other people don't need the range extender because they're closer to the
floor. Yeah. So you could take the range extender out, make that a hardwired router in your apartment. And actually, you'd turn off the routing function, and it would just be a wireless access point.
Turn off the routing function. Yeah.
It doesn't need to be a router. You only want one router on your network. But it does need to be a wireless access point.
Okay.
So that would be in the setup screen on the Buffalo is to
and so that it can broadcast from
there. Right. That creates wireless but not a second network. It uses the existing network.
Okay.
That's often in the setup screen you tell it you're gonna join an existing network instead of creating a new network.
Okay. And so that's likely to give me a much better signal setup for the iPhone.
Right. You'd have hardwired to your computer and then that would be wireless
this then from this
from the app. Yep.
Okay. Now, is this the right device? Because this says 300 Mbps. So this is 300, but
mm-hmm.
There's another 600 version.
Yeah, there are better ones that would give you faster speed. Generally, I don't need it.
Oh, okay.
Generally, that your internet is 10 or 20 at most.
Oh, it's well, 300?
Yeah.
Oh.
So the 300 is mostly for transferring large files between computers.
Okay.
Or if you had 10 people using the 300, they'd each get 30.
Oh.
So the 300 is fine. The issue is that the AC routers that are 1300, they have a stronger signal to begin with. So you could put an AC router on your first floor, replacing your current Netgear router, and you may not need another router anywhere else.
Okay, I don't know what the capacity of the Time Warner one is, but this certainly does not expand the capacity, whatever that is. So 300 versus 600 is not going to make a difference for me.
Right.
Now, I was thinking that it might make a difference in terms of the capability of doing videos on the iPhone.
No, only if you had 20 people connected at the same time.
Because sometimes videos stop in the middle.
Mm-hmm. Usually that's the other end. The computer's sending you the video. Or your Wi-Fi signal is dropping out. And it stops the video while it buffers some more.
Yeah, because I move the phone around and then it might come back in.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes, when it just stops, particularly if I want to fast forward through a video by putting my thumb on the dot and moving it, and then the whole thing stops and waits for it to be at that point. And if it doesn't start right away, I find that I just press the home button and then press it again, and then it'll start off.
It's had a chance to buffer some more.
Well, not just the time, but it kind of kickstarted.
Mm-hmm. So if you're getting a weak wireless signal, that can cause an interruption in the stream.
And this will solve that for
Right, you'll now have a strong wireless signal in your apartment.
I didn't want to open this up until I heard from you on it. So you say go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, I had a related question. I have a friend, and I sold her an iMac. She wants to get rid of her Time Warner router.
Mm-hmm.
I think her router is both Wi-Fi and... Right.
Yeah, and then Time Warner charges more for that.
Yeah, well, so basically she wants a recommendation.
The Surfboard 6141 is great. I think we're using the Zoom 53, what is it, 5375 is the one we use now? No, not 53, how about 5735, yeah. They are generally cable only, and for wireless you would use a separate Wi-Fi router, because you often replace your Wi-Fi router much more frequently than you do your cable modem. It's 53 something. $53.41, so that's $350.
Mbps means?
Megabits per second. That's not the one we had, because ours was vertical. We go to other cable modems.
I use
5370, that's the one we've been using.
I use an Airport Express for my Wi-Fi at home, and I got another one of those somewhere in the basement, and so I might be able to provide her with that, but she'd still need a router.
Well, the Express is a router. Wireless, it's a wireless access point and a router.
Okay.
So there's basically two pieces. You've got your cable modem that converts the coax cable line into a computer signal, generally Ethernet.
Right.
And then you've got your wireless router that takes that Ethernet signal and turns it into a radio,
so
Wi-Fi.
You still need the modem then.
Right. You would need the modem for the cable connection and then the wireless for Wi-Fi. You can get one that does both. They have one. They have an N and they have an AC that does both. But when you want to replace your Wi-Fi with faster Wi-Fi, you end up replacing your cable modem too. Let's see, does this have prices? Generally, the cable modems are in the $100 range. So this one's $129. So this is wired and wire. Oh, that's not too bad. Wired and wireless, Ethernet and coax. You know, coax in, Ethernet out. For $129, that's actually pretty good. The one limitation is it only does 343 megabit. The Time Warner maximum now is 50 for their high-end, expensive version. The standard Time Warner is 20. So the fact that this is 350, you're doing a lot better than Time Warner offers anyway.
Her current one also provides Wi-Fi. This doesn't. Right?
This is both. This is Wi-Fi and cable. So it's got the AC Wi-Fi in it.
Oh, that's what that stands for, AC.
Yeah. I think. Yeah, antenna. So AC at 1900 megabit.
It's 130,
yeah. And this is on Time Warner's approved list, I'm pretty sure. Yeah. So if you buy your own cable modem and it's not on their approved list, they may refuse to set it up for you.
No, probably whatever set up.
I think I could explore with Metro, but not the
It wouldn't hurt if you've got nothing better to do for a couple hours. But the fact that you're trying to go from first floor to third floor is probably the bigger issue.
And I put the range extender on the second floor.
Which is a good thing. It might be the range extender is the problem and not the main router.
Mm-hmm. And this other one seems to work fine, and it's just been only last week that I've had the problem occurring happened many months ago.
How well do you know your neighbors? Did one of them just put in a ham radio?
No, and I find this problem after midnight, which is not when I think other people are using it.
Yeah. We had a customer once where their computer would just go crazy at random times during the day. We finally figured out that the next office on the other side of her wall was the kitchen. And the microwave oven was pointing at her computer. So anytime someone heated their coffee, her computer went nuts.
I thought the microwave ovens were supposed to have shielding.
They do, but not as much as they could.
At least in front of it. Remember, the computers used to have no protection on the back.
So all the people that had set up the cubicles,
yes.
You got four computers with the CRTs pointing at each other. We would still see that. You turn your CRT on, it would shoot a beam right out the back and mess up the guy diagonal to you, and his screen would go nuts.
And not only messing up the screen, but the people, the operators.
Yeah, it could, yeah.
Radiation, which they didn't think they were getting.
Mm-hmm. So the switch to flat screens was a huge improvement on several fronts, including the EMI.
And of course, now it's LCDs, so it has that radiation from the screens, like you did with CRTs.
Yep.
New York Times crossword puzzle this week.
Can you scroll up a little bit? Up.
Had a clue, five letters, Apple on devices.
What is DOCSIS?
DOCSIS. Yeah, that's the cable modem industry standard name. Data over cable internet service specification. Yeah, what was the
like
people like their protocols.
Like you, I was just thinking, devices.
Yep.
Five letters.
Or then I started thinking about, an apple fruit, and what would that mean? And
I kept wanting to put in the four-letter word logo, but no.
Yep. All righty. Any last questions?
Content there about the Russian hacking that relates to us in terms of anything we could be part of this. The way in which they were hacking. This was a lengthy New York Times and Washington Post article about how Russia did the hacking, and it went in great detail.
Sponsored by the Russian government, they went through several intermediaries to try to hide their tracks.
And they were able to reverse.
There's some fat Russian guy on his bed.
Well, and they found out exactly where everything originated. And knew who to blame, but they wouldn't say exactly how. Trump says, oh, you got to show us all the details. No. When you're trying to find out these guys, you don't want to disclose to them how you're doing it so they can hide your tracks better.
One detail I heard was something came to...
I like this picture. A file cabinet from Watergate.
Yeah, the contrast.
Yep.
One of Hillary's guys, I forget his name offhand.
Podesta.
And one of his subordinates got this thing, and he asked if this was a real one. But anyway, he responded to it, and that was their hook to get in.
Yes.
He had responded to basically junk mail.
And I read about that a couple years ago. A volunteer worker was using her personal email address for I forget whether it was RNC or DNC, for official email. And it was a Yahoo address that she was getting hacked by. And she kept getting these messages from Yahoo that says, it appears someone else is trying to hack into your account. And she kept telling people, and no one bothered doing anything about it until it got completely breached, and someone else started sending out email in her name. And why they didn't give her an RNC, DNC, whatever email address, made her use her personal email account for sending out her messages, was interesting. But they no one takes computer seriously computer security serious until it affects them.
Well, in the case of John Podesta, the chair of the PMC, he allowed about a dozen people to use his email, and one of those people got this message that you've got to change your password to appear and do that.
Yep, a fake message, and
that's how the whole thing started.
Well, that's the irony of the whole thing. I mean, she's clearly derailed by the email thing, and 90%, 80% of the people have no idea what that really means. I mean, basically, I interpret it as she was naive about technology, not that knowledgeable. And so it was a thing, but there was never any criminal intent. You know, it was a non-story that they just blew up and made this crazy, you know, the more they could say emails and servers and things that the average person has no concept, no idea what that all entails.
And the State Department servers that people said she should have been using.
Yeah. And Colin Powell did the same thing, and so did Rice. They had private email. I don't know if they had their own server.
So Paul Ryan won't say
it has
been
reported to the State Department service.
Mm-hmm. Seth Meyers, one of the late night talk show hosts, I saw this before the election, trying to sum up the differences between Trump and Clinton.
Trump's name, but will vote for him for president. And that's a problem for a lot of Americans. They just don't love the two choices. I mean, do you pick someone who's under federal investigation for using a private email server? Or do you pick someone who called Mexicans rapists, claimed the president was born in Kenya, proposed banning an entire religion from entering the U.S., mocked a disabled reporter, said John McCain wasn't a war hero because he was captured, attacked the parents of a fallen soldier, bragged about committing sexual assault, was accused of 12 women of committing sexual assault, said some of those women weren't attractive enough for him to sexually assault, said more countries should get nuked, said he would be forced the military to commit war crimes, said a judge was biased because his parents were Mexicans, said women should be punished for having abortions, incited violence at his rallies, called global warming a hoax perpetrated by the Chinese, called for his opponent to be jailed, declared bankruptcy 6 times, bragged about not paying income taxes, stiffed his contractors and employees, lost $1 billion in 1 year, scammed customers at his fake university, bought a 6-foot-tall painting of himself with money from his fake foundation, has a trial for fraud coming up in November, insulted an opponent's looks, insulted an opponent's wife's looks, and bragged about grabbing women by the How do you choose?
I kind of got a kick out of that.
Okay, well, I'm going to
But Hillary's a crook because Trump said so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just got a notification of a video show school bus driver releasing Trump students first.
And how true is that? Alrighty, well, thanks everyone for coming.
Thank you.
Our next meeting will be January 11th back at East High School.
Okay.
Rick took his GarageBand presentation he did a month or so ago and turned it into an ebook and is publishing it online. So now he's a published musician and a published author.
Wow.
I had a question about the old Toad, they have the whiskey and chocolate.
Yeah.
Is there some fee or anything to get participate in that? Or?
Shirley said there wasn't, but I can't believe they would have a whiskey tasting. For free. Event. December 15th. December, what date is the, the meeting? What date is Wednesday? I can't even think now. Board meeting is
17th.
Board meeting is the 21st. So we got the 15th, the 18th, the 31st. I don't.
December. 31st
is I don't see anything about whiskey tasting.
Yeah, no biggie. Okay. Merry holidays.
Yep, you too.
See you in January. See you next year. Thank you. I always learn so much from you. I really appreciate it.
Hanukkah and Christmas coincide this year. Did I spell it right? We'll see. Festivus. Festivus for the rest of us.
Yes.
December 23rd. And your Festivus poll. Unadorned and non-lit. Nice. One coat over the top, yep.
One coat over the line?
Yep. Alright, let me close out my windows here. I have windows on my Mac. Tra-la-la guy, AT&T guy. Go back in time and see all the stuff we talked about. Mm-hmm. Trusted devices, Scrabble. This one, that I want to keep because I want to watch it.
Where are you right now?
Pardon? Oh, sorry.
You're where? Oh, okay, well, how soon do you think you can be here at the JCC?
Leave that open, and we will shut down our broadcast.
Okay, I'm inside a building. I don't